It's interesting because it involves our dear, dear Taylor Swift, which I'm not the biggest fan of Taylor Swift, but I am such a huge fan of her work ethic, such a huge fan of her ingenuity when it comes to dealing with these corporate entities that just want a piece of her money. Like, I loved how she went around distribution companies in Hollywood and just directly made a deal with AMC to distribute her film herself, her Eras Tour concert. I just thought it was beautiful. Yes, there's a conspiracy going down, or her dad's wealth. Yeah, you know, that too. You know, she had a leg up. She definitely had a leg up. But what I will say is that she has written or co-written every single song that she's recorded and put out. How many artists can say that? Beyonce can't say that shit. Fuck no, she can't. One song has like 14 writers on it. So mad respect. I'm not the biggest fan of her music. I guess Shake It Off might be fun to dance to or something, but I don't know. There is something about her that turns my stomach. Is it that she's a Kansas City Chiefs fan? I don't know anything about football, nor do I care. Fair enough, Naders. I get it. But so Jesse Waters posited this conspiracy, and or is it? So let's watch this video here and.
Taylor Swift's the biggest star in the world.
We'll find out.
Sorry, Gutfeld. She's been blanketed across the sports media entertainment atmosphere. The New York Times just speculated she's a lesbian. And last year's tour broke Ticketmaster.
Wait, okay,
the tour that's
hold on.
Revenue tops.
This is why I don't like this kind of fucking Fox News and this guy in particular. He's like, the New York Times just called her a lesbian. Which they did. And by the way, like, why? Why would you do that?
Why are you gay?
Why would you even fucking say that about Taylor Swift? Like, it was such a dumb article. Like, we're gonna speculate that she's all fucking flaming lesbo. Like, come on, man. Like,
come on, man.
You know?
Come on, man.
She's a reptiloid. She might be. But this is what I don't like about this fucking whole thing right here. But anyways, moving on, he's making a point, I suppose. Like, kissing girls, how I need my Bible. Yeah. Like, kissing girls, I need my Bible. Give me my Bible. Give me my Bible. I need my Bible. I need to repent. This is the only repenting I have right here, all right? I'm just gonna keep doing that. Okay, here we go.
It's the GDP of 50 countries.
She made
a
lot of money.
She's all right. But I mean, have you ever wondered why or how she blew up like this? Well, around 4 years ago, the Pentagon's Psychological Operations Unit floated turning Taylor Swift into an asset during a NATO meeting. What kind of asset? A PSYOP for combating online misinformation. Listen.
You came in here wanting to understand how you just go out there and counter an information operation. Well, the idea is that social influence can help encourage or promote behavior change, so potentially as like a peaceful information operation. I include Taylor Swift in here because she's, you know, she's a fairly influential online person. I don't know if you've heard of her.
Okay. So, to be fair, she did not say Taylor Swift is an operative that we are tapping to battle dis and misinformation online. She said this is an example. So they're just floating an example. And what they're saying over here, it says on screen, the goal, identify key actors to train and spread desired messaging. Okay, we're talking about the government tapping artists. And this is what they're saying to NATO. And I don't believe that these are actually government officials, right? I think one person is from Mozilla. And the other person is, he'll tell us. But and then so an example of what they would want from Taylor Swift would be to encourage opinion leaders to share counter IO content. I don't know what IO content, but I'm guessing it's some sort of mis or disinformation. Risk. Opinion leaders may not want to share content or may accidentally share misleading content. So we also have to watch out for people who are misleading. Celebrities or influencers are misleading people. And then it says, so identification, this says segmentation. I don't know what that means. It's but it's just another thing there. It says target accounts in well-connected group or in shared positions. So they're targeting people. Locate and target highly connected accounts with counter IO training. Yeah. Risk may be perceived as an attack on the community. Or, yes, I could see that. So they're not saying Taylor is that, but they're saying the idea is to tap into these influencers. Do that. By the way, we saw this with TikTok. They clearly reached out to these people. And they clearly were talking, they're tapping into these huge influencers on TikTok, having them talk real good about the Biden administration and about Democrats and their narratives, pushing narratives. So this is something that they do. And is it beyond the possibility that they would do this with a celebrity? It is not, by the way. That's the answer is it is not. So let's listen to fucking Water Jesse here.
Yeah, that's real. The Pentagon Psyop unit pitched NATO on turning Taylor Swift into an asset for combating misinformation online. This is nothing new. In the 1950s, the government strong-armed Louis Armstrong into doing propaganda tours across Africa. The CIA did the same thing with jazz singer Nina Simone, except they did it without her really knowing. In the 70s, Nixon enlisted Elvis in his war on drugs. He gave the king a badge and named him a covert federal law enforcement agent. Michael Jackson was tapped by Reagan, using his song Beat It in his public service campaigns against teen drinking and driving. Michael Jackson persuading minors not to drink.
Okay, that was a good joke. That was a good one right there. I'll give it to him. I'll give Jesse Waters that smug son of a bitch. I'll give that one to him. That was funny. Her next breakup song will be about the government. She's breaking up with the government. So, are they stupid? Why do they want the kind of people don't listen to? Black people and women. actually, in America at least, there's a lot of people who listen to women, and there's a lot of people who listen to black people. I mean, black people are very influential on black people. I mean, think about why violence is pushed so hard in rap music. Why is violence pushed so hard? And we went over this, right? Like, the prison industrial complex is owned by the same people who own the fucking labels, who own the same companies that benefit from the slave labor that the prisoners have to do when they're in prison. So they own the thing. So why wouldn't they want fucking black people to be killing their own and feeding this industrial complex, this prison industrial complex? I mean, that might be far-fetched, but it's very interesting that the same company owns those three markets, right? So yes, people are very influential. Black people are very influential. Women are very influential. Taylor Swift is very, very influential. And, she's a billionaire now. Like, her tour made, I think, like $1 billion or something. Like, she is on top of the world. Like, last year was Taylor Swift's year. She is at the pinnacle of all this shit. So, Jesse Waters, right? Talking about black people. Now, I see what you're saying too, especially back in the day, in the time of Louis Armstrong. So he started with Louis Armstrong. Let's just take a break from fuckface McGee here, smug asshole, and check out this. So this is from The Guardian a couple years ago. And this is a great article. It's called Louis Armstrong and the Spy: How the CIA Used Him as a Trojan Horse in the Congo. So Louis Armstrong, and I believe he was unwittingly acting with the CIA. But let's read this article through and find out, shall we? It was a memorable evening. Louis Armstrong, his wife, and a diplomat from the U.S. Embassy were out for dinner in a restaurant in what was still Leopoldville, capital in the newly independent Congo. The trumpeter, singer, and band leader, nicknamed Satchmo as a child, was in the middle of a tour of Africa that would stretch over months, organized and sponsored by the State Department in a bid to improve the image of the U.S. in dozens of countries which had just won freedom from colonial regimes. So they're it's propaganda. American propaganda is like, look how cool we are. We're all about you guys being free because we're all about democracy, right? We're going to spread democracy through music to get a better image of America. What Armstrong did not know was that his host that night in November 1960 was not the political attaché as described, but the head of the CIA in Congo. He was also totally unaware of how his fame had allowed the spy who was making small talk across the starters to gain crucial information that would facilitate some of the most controversial operations of the entire Cold War. Armstrong was basically a Trojan horse for the CIA. It's genuinely heartbreaking. He was brought in to serve an interest that was completely contrary to his own sense of what was right or wrong. He would have been horrified, said Susan Williams, a research fellow at London University School of Advanced Studies and author of White Malice, a new book which exposes the astonishing extent of the CIA's activities across Central and West Africa in the 1950s and early 60s. So this was a way for the CIA to sort of infiltrate through the guise of, you know, spreading democracy through art, through the American art form that is jazz. This is a very American, very African-American art form, but American nonetheless. Documents found by Williams in the archives of the UN during 5 years of research strongly suggest that Armstrong's host, CIA station chief Larry Devlin, and other U.S. intelligence officers posted to Congo used the cover of the musician's visit to get access to strategically important and very wealthy province of Katanga, which had recently seceded. The U.S., though sympathetic to the agenda of the province's leader, had not officially recognized the self-declared government there. There was much of interest to the CIA in Katanga, ranging from senior officials with whom they could not otherwise meet to crucial mining infrastructures. Of course, it's about mining and resources, which Africa is still being raped to this day. By what? By France, I think. France is still raping and taking their wealth and shit. Like, China, definitely. They're just fucking, they're just brazen about it. And, of course, America. Because these fucking phones we have, how do you think we're going to get cheap phones if we don't have slave African labor fucking digging out lithium? I don't know. All I know is I don't want to pay more for my shit. There was a lot of, with 1,500 tons of uranium and vast potential to procure more uranium, which is a very vital ingredient to the atomic bomb. Armstrong's tour to Katanga was the perfect opportunity. So Devlin and others flew down from the capital with the musician and his famous band. They needed a cover, and this gave them one, said Williams. Very convenient. Man, I fucking... And I gotta say that Louis Armstrong is one of my favorite jazz musicians, singers ever. Like, the best fucking... one of my most prized records is the collaboration between Ella Fitzgerald and Louis Armstrong. It's like fucking audible Valium. It's anytime you need to just come down you hear fucking Louis Armstrong and Ella Fitzgerald singing fucking My Lovely Valentine, right? It's just an easy fucking song, simple. It just covered hundreds of thousands of times, but this people just bring such soul into it. It's just incredible. I love them. I love them very much, very much, very much a part of my life in very integral ways. There was something else that Armstrong, who had pulled out of a similar tour to the Soviet Union 3 years earlier in protest at racism in the U.S., There was something else that Armstrong, who had pulled out of a similar tour in the Soviet Union 3 years earlier in protest at racism in the U.S., did not know. The CIA in the Congo, led by Devlin, was trying to kill the Congo's first democratically elected prime minister, 35-year-old Patrice Lumumba. Fearful that he would lead the country into the Soviet camp. Historians now believe that the nationalist leader wanted his country to remain neutral in the Cold War. And this is what the CIA does. This is what they've been doing for decades now. I mean, this is what happened in Iraq. They go, or the Arab Spring. The Arab Spring was very much a CIA-backed coup, where we install our own leaders and therefore our policies get to go down and therefore your resources are now our resources. It's a playbook. It's what they've been doing for a long, long time. And this is like the beginning of those habits that they picked up. Overturn a government, assassinate the leader, whatever it is. They just go in and do it and take all the resources they can. They loot it. Give me the loot. Just a mile or so from where Armstrong and Devlin had dined, the charismatic Lumumba, was being held prisoner in his official residence by soldiers loyal to Joseph Desire Mobutu, the young military chief with the close working relationship with the CIA, who had effectively seized power some weeks earlier. Look at that. Somebody working with the CIA was put in power. Gee whiz, isn't that something? Within 2 months of Armstrong's tour, Lumumba was murdered in Katanga by officials of the breakaway province and police officers from Belgium. Belgium still raping Africa. Mobutu would later consolidate his hold on Congo and become a loyal U.S. client. Of course, they're going to sit him down, show him the body of the predecessor, Lumumba. They're going to be like, this is you if you don't play ball. Now, where's that uranium, big guy? Come on over here, you big old lug. Need some more of this. It's only been 2 hours. Wow, it feels like it's been longer than 2 hours. Within 2 months of Armstrong's tour, Lumumba was murdered. Oh, yeah, we know that. Devlin later claimed that the CIA was responsible, telling a U.S. congressional investigation that the coup of Mobutu was arranged and supported and indeed managed by the CIA. So there was a congressional hearing about it, and they found out. Our investigation, and they found out that was true, that this was a whole setup. The killing of Lumumba would be one of the most infamous episodes of the Cold War and prompted outrage all over the world. While accepting responsibility for the coup, the CIA has always denied involvement. In 1975, Devlin told the government inquiry in the U.S. that the agency had been trying to assassinate the nationalist leader over previous months, but had ceased their operation long before the actual murder. Of course, they're going to deny. It's just how, like the FBI at January 6th, was there informants in the crowd? I cannot confirm or deny. Thank you. That's just how they work, right? That's how they operate. Williams, however, found evidence that cast doubt on the reliability of Devlin's testimony. Recently released U.S. documents show that the CIA station chief sent an agent known as Wee Rogue, to Thiesville, the town where Lumumba was imprisoned in the weeks before his death, well after the agency claimed to have dropped all interest in the possible assassination of the popular politician. So one of their own agents, Wee Rogue, was sent in, and all of a sudden he died mysteriously. And here we go. We can't say that Wee Rogue did in Thiesville, but it does undermine Devlin's reliability at the very least. The CIA had begun developing a network of agents, hired helpers, collaborators, and clients in Africa soon after its creation in 1947, building on work done during the Second World War. By 1960, this vast web comprised trade union leaders, businessmen, cultural and educational organizations, businesses, and even airlines. Wow. Doing the work, gentlemen. The agency would be implicated in some of the most significant events in the continent's post-colonial history. In 1962, a tip from a CIA spy to officials of the racist, repressive apartheid regime in South Africa may have led to the arrest of Nelson Mandela and his imprisonment for 27 years. Gosh darn. A tip from the CIA, from a CIA spy to officials of the racist repressive. Okay. So, you know, the CIA is even helping Nelson Mandela get in prison, during like a for real apartheid, for real racist apartheid. Like, this is real racism right here, folks. It's not fucking microaggressions. It's like straight up, there's a separate system that you must abide to while we get to enjoy the spoils of your land. And something very similar that's going on in Palestine right now. Similar. Maybe even spot on. While the agency has also been blamed for the overthrow of Ghana's first president, Kwame Nkrumah, in a military coup in 1966. So, yeah, I mean, it goes on and on. This is what they do. The tragedy is Nkrumah and Lumumba and a number of other African leaders in the book weren't opposed to the U.S. They wanted friendly relations with the U.S., but because they weren't opposed to the Soviets either, they were seen as enemies by Washington. The attitude was, you're either with us or against us, which is a very, I remember George Bush, you're even with us or you're with them. That George Bush, George Dubs, G Dubs. It's a sentiment that has been echoed throughout the decades. And in a sense, I feel that as well. It's like, you're either with me or against me. Fuck you. But when we're talking about nation building and geopolitical relations, it's a very cut and dry approach. Armstrong, who was 59 when he traveled to Congo, was inspired by his experiences there to collaborate on the making of a musical called The Real Ambassadors, written by Dave and Iola Brubeck, which was performed and became an album. It voiced some of his own deeply conflicted sentiments about the participation in the U.S. government public relations effort on the continent. Though I represent the government, said the musician in the work, the government don't represent some policies I'm for. Which, at the time, yeah, it was a really fucked up time in America. A lot of black people weren't on board with all that shit. This article was amended on 15 September, an earlier version said Louis Armstrong composed The Real Ambassadors. In fact, Dave Brubeck and Iola Brubeck wrote the music and lyrics respectively. A quote from the musical song was also corrected. Some policies, not some of the policies. Well, I can appreciate The Guardian telling us that they did, that they edited this, and that this has been updated, because the New York Times, in the night, they just alter history. They don't even tell you. Just there's all kinds of it's interesting how just in the past few years this has been going on, that just in the dark of night they'll just change history. They'll just say something else. So that is Louis Armstrong and the story of how he was used by the CIA. So again, is Taylor Swift an operative for the Pentagon? I don't know. She might be unwittingly, right? Like, it could be one of those things where she is encouraged. Maybe someone in her camp is encouraged by an outsider to vote for Joe Biden, right? Or, you know, I mean, and here's the other thing, is that shit happens all the time. To influence elections, of course, people from the election, from the party, are going to reach out to celebrities who might be, you know, willing to donate their time, money, or say something online. Obama, right? Beyonce, Jay-Z, all endorsed him. Very influential people, right? So it's not an uncommon thing, and it's not some clandestine operation, right? It's just kind of business as usual. But again, she could be manipulated unwittingly, such as Satchmo. Satchmo the Great, man. Fucking amazing. Now, Elvis is a little bit of a different story. Now, Elvis, he's a fucking wild man. But Elvis was someone who, you know, he was very much against drugs and the hippie movement. He hated the Beatles. He thought that the Beatles were going to bring America down and turn it into a communist state. And this story is actually really interesting and funny. But again, it's another instance of the U.S. government using an icon. All right, buddy. You have a great evening, Naders. Thank you so much for hanging out. I'll see you on the flippity flop. Stay up, baby. Stay up. All right. So dumb. Elvis Presley bitterly denounced the Beatles for their anti-Americanism during a White House meeting with President Nixon in December 1970. The rock and roll star, who died of long-term drug abuse in 1977, also told the president that he could influence the hippie movement against the use of drugs and asked to be made a federal drug enforcement agent. Eventually, he was given a specially made Bureau of Narcotics badge. A note of the encounter is one of 1.5 million documents from Mr. Nixon's presidential papers, finally made public by the National Archivist in Washington. The former president has fought tenaciously for the past 12 years to prevent their appearance, citing everything from executive privilege to personal privacy. Now he has been overruled by the combined judgment of Congress, the Supreme Court, most recently the U.S. government archivist. Naders has left the building. Uh-huh. We're talking about Naders. The present avalanche, however, is the merest taster of Mr. Nixon's presidential years. For more than a decade, 24 archivists have been sorting and cataloging 20,000 boxes, estimated to contain 40 million documents. Elvis Presley's approach to Mr. Nixon came in an astoundingly ill-written letter. "Dear Mr. President," the singer wrote, first, I would like to introduce myself. I am Elvis Presley, and admire you and have a great respect for your office." Uh-huh. The letter expressing concern about the drug culture and the hippie elements, Black Panthers, led to a White House meeting on December 21st. And you know, these movements, these hippie movements and the Black Panther movements, especially the Black Panther movement, we had Nixon talking about, you know, he's on record saying that this war on drugs was a way to take down these radical, like radicals like the Black Panthers, by being able to go in and bust them for drug use and take them off the streets. It also allowed them to allow a lot of drugs onto the streets. We definitely have proof that Freeway Ricky Ross, an LA drug dealer and gangbanger, was selling cocaine for the U.S. government so they could fund the Sandinistas, I believe that's what it was, back in the 80s. And there was the crack epidemic that was allowed to happen by our government, the CIA. So again, lots of people out there being used by the government in these ways. An official memorandum recorded that Presley indicated that he thought the Beatles had been a real force for anti-American spirit. He said that the Beatles came to this country, made their money, then returned to England where they promoted an anti-American theme. The president nodded in agreement and expressed some surprise. The president then indicated that those who use drugs are also in the vanguard of anti-American protests. Presley spent most of the rest of the meeting telling Mr. Nixon that he wanted to give his name to the administration's law and order campaign to restore some respect to the flag. The first tranche of the huge number of documents contains its time bomb, not least the disclosure that President Reagan's current White House communications director, Mr. Patrick Buchanan, warned Mr. Nixon against visiting Mrs. Coretta Scott King on the anniversary of her husband's murder. Oh, God. Pat Buchanan was trying to get the president not to meet with Coretta? It's fucked up. Martin Luther King, Mr. Buchanan. Okay. We all love Martin. And, hey, happy MLK Day, everybody. What's going on? What is this? Is that it? Okay. That can't be it. Oh, you son of a bitch. We don't get to see this? Anyways, at the end of the day, Nixon gave him a badge. It was nothing official, but he was used, and he was very anti-drug and anti-hippie, even though he was high on drugs until the day he died on his golden toilet. My man. What a way to go, baby. Die alone in your bathroom. let me see. Freeway Ricky Ross and CIA. CIA contra crack controversy, cocaine controversy. And look, this is from the Justice Department. Oh, God, we're not reading that. Fuck that. Give us someone drug keeping. There we go. The Daily Beast. Let's go. Freeway Ricky Ross, who Rick Ross actually stole his name from, again, drug dealer. Excuse me. Hold on. All right. Here we go. The Daily Beast is not bad. What does Freeway Freeway Ricky Ross, the drug kingpin, have to do with Martin Luther King and the 50th anniversary of the Selma March? Good question. Freeway, crack in the system, has been invited by the Jubilee Film Festival to close next weekend's historic events in Selma, Alabama. Now, what does our documentary on the crack era and the man at its epicenter, Freeway Rick, have to do with this epic civil rights confrontation and galvanized the nation half a century ago?
Look at you reading the word galvanized.
Thank you. I did it myself. The movie Selma and the common And Common and John Legend's mesmerizing Oscar night performance of Glory provide the answer. Selma is now, Legend said, explained, we live in the most incarcerated country in the world. The mass incarceration. Okay, start. Why are you, what are you doing?
I'm changing. I just got home from swim, mom, bro.
The mass incarceration of so many men of color is the new Jim Crow, the title of Michelle Alexander's groundbreaking book. As she says in the film, what explains the sudden explosion in incarceration, if not crime and crime rates? Well, the answer is the war on drugs and the get tough movement. Now, hold on, I'll tell right now. I yelled it at her. She left the room. Yeah, and of course, the war on drugs was predicated on a racist notion to break up Black Panther movement and these hippie movements. It's very well documented as, Nixon admits it. He admits it. How did we get from glorious battles of the civil rights movement to the devastation of the crack plague? From the police crackdown on the marchers on the Selma Bridge to the police killings of Michael Brown and Eric Garner. Why are they even bringing all that stuff? Just get to the point, guys. Those are terrible things that happened, but God damn it, just tell us the story. From the nonviolence movement of courageous civil rights activists to the gang of violence that has made homicide the number one cause of death for young Black men, and finally the impassioned eloquence of Dr. King's I Have a Dream to the drug kingpin's I Have a Life Sentence. And it all sort of does go together really well. The war on drugs is over 40 years old, but during the crack era in the 1980s, it was kicked into overdrive. The stage was set by a changing global economy that moved traditional industry and jobs from American cities to underdeveloped countries, which is NAFTA, I believe. The Reagan administration escalated the urban plight by cutting back social service programs and job training, while at the same time privatizing many public services, including prisons, building prisons and keeping them full of, and became a big business. Then dropped tons of low-cost, high-quality white powder into the mix. Boom, the underground economy explodes. Rick and the Freeway Boys originally called their cocaine product Ready Rock. You ready to rock? They thought they could take Hollywood's luxury high and bring it cross town to the hood, which they did a very good job. Little did they imagine the consequences. Once the drugs damaging effect were known, media hysteria broke out. In 1986, President Reagan signed a law that made possession of 5 grams of crack the same as 500 grams of powder cocaine. Mandatory minimums were compounded in the 90s by the introduction of the 3-strike laws, adding decades to a sentence of repeat offenders. Yeah, that's 3 strikes. That's California right there, man. They don't fuck around. So began the mass incarceration of a generation of young men of color. Since 1980, the number of people behind bars for drugs has grown from 41,000 to 500,000. Despite supposed equal treatment under law, African Americans are sent to prisons for drug offenses at 10 times the rate as white. God damn it. I wish they would just start talking about the CIA. I get that. I totally get that. Incarceration and prohibition proved to be a disastrous combination, which, yes, it has been. Thousands of low-level street dealers and drug addicts were sentenced to years in prison. The Freeway Boys deployed the local Bloods and Crips to distribute the drugs, and they quickly expanded into national gangs. Military-grade weapons and criminal hands escalated the violence, turning the police into an occupying army in many inner-city neighborhoods. Lack of department funds and big money bust exposed officers to harsh ethical dilemmas. Some became dirty cops, like Roberto Juarez, a top undercover for the LA Sheriff's Department, who testifies in our documentary, we had gone from being cops to being crooks, which happens all the time. I first heard CIA equals crack in America around the time of the Iran-Contra hearings in 1986, which I was covering as a young producer. But in the Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist Gary Webb, who blew the story open with Dark Alliance, his 1996 series for the San Jose Mercury News, Webb put a spotlight on the CIA and the Reagan administration's unholy alliance with anti-communist guerrillas and their supporters who were involved in drug trafficking. He uncovered how tons of cocaine were shipped into San Francisco by supporters of the CIA, backed Contras, and then distributed to LA to Nicaraguan named Danilo Blandon, who sold it to a street dealer from South Central Freeway, Ricky Ross. Woo, baby, what is up, baby boo? Oh, okay. I guess that's not working. I guess the woos ain't working today, folks. So they were selling drugs, bringing it in to San Francisco, putting it into the hands of a, what was his name? A holy alliance with the guerrilla supporters already uncovered. What was his name? Danilo Blandon. And he was handling it. This was Nicaraguan, and the money they were using, I believe the money they were using was the fund, the shit that was going down there. This is the story that rocked Black America and led to all sorts of conspiracy theories and urban legends. It is also the story that goes to the fundamental hypocrisy of corruption of this failed war on drugs. And absolutely, if you've ever hung out in the hood, or if you've ever hung out, if you ever listened to hip hop, Tupac is like, they are the ones who put these drugs in these communities to break these communities up. When I tracked down Blandon in Nicaragua, he said to me, Gary Webb tried to find me. Congresswoman Maxine Waters tried to find me. Oliver Stone tried to find me. You found me. Although we would not go on film, Blandon agreed that the war on drugs was futile and a failure, which is very fucking true. As Tommy McDonald of the Drug Policy Alliance says in the documentary, drugs are really bad, but the drug war is worse. Today, we may finally be reaching the tipping point. The decriminalization and legalization of marijuana is gaining momentum, which is very true, and which in part led to the fentanyl problem that's going on right now. Because when you legalize marijuana and you take that out of the equation for the cartels to ship over large amounts of weed, they move on to other product. It's like, you can't sell cartel weed in America anymore. Okay, well, I know what will sell: coca and the heroin, or the fentanyl, which the Chinese send over the raw materials, and the Mexican cartels put the materials together, and then they just walk that shit right over the border because our borders are wide open. And fentanyl killed Prince and Tom Petty and Mac Miller. So, I mean, this is all connected, man. This war on drugs has only made things horrible in Mexico. It's only made things even worse here for the poor and for people who... You grow up in a shitty neighborhood where everything's crumbling around you. Everybody's selling drugs and your mom's fucked up and you don't know where your dad's at. And what else do you have? Your influence is people who are probably bigger than you and that could whoop your ass. War on drugs is the stupidest thing ever. And racist. Completely and utterly racist. We got that. Freeway Ricky Ross is now a free man after serving 20 years in federal prison. Like over half of those incarcerated, Rick was illiterate until he was 28. He learned to read in prison and became a jailhouse lawyer, eventually winning an appeal to get his sentence reduced. Today, his mission is to teach literacy, reading, writing, financial, and media to those whom educators find the hardest to reach. He acknowledges the terrible damage crack created, especially in African-American communities, and he is now trying to give back. Like Freeway Rick's journey, the nation's path to equality and progress is no straight road. It is full of twists and turns and convolutions and contradictions. We have the first Black president while the Supreme Court and conservatives try to roll back voting rights. Let me see. This is all going on. If Rick Ross can connect his crimes, his punishments, and redemption with these young people and show them futility and violence and the importance of education, discipline, and hard work and the power of literacy, then maybe he can be a bridge that also connects these kids to the grandparents' struggle. Yeah, and so there you go. This was not the greatest article to read on this story, but it is. I mean, it's really fucked up that this is what happened, and the CIA fucking led this, and they were selling drugs in the community through fucking this guy, and he's not even a musician, right? He's not a musician, but he is a writer and author and stuff, and he but this is how the CIA operates, right? So the one thing I was trying to find was the one on Nina Simone. There was a I didn't bring it up. Oh, it's in this one. Look, how could the CIA have planted hair metal propaganda during the Cold War? More stuff. Here's this: how the CIA learned to rock. So this is another thing that we got going on here. And this one mentions Nina Simone, who I am a huge fan of as well. Shut up. Get out of here. Okay. So James Jesus Angleton. That sounds like a cuss in the category of porn. Now, James Jesus Angleton. That sounds like if you stubbed your toe. James Jesus Angleton. God damn, that hurt. James Jesus Angleton, chief of CIA counterintelligence from 1954 to 1975, was nicknamed the poet. Before he was a spy, he had literary aspirations. As an undergraduate at Yale, he wrote verse and, more impressively, co-edited the literary journal Furioso, which published poets like E.E. Cummings, Ezra Pound, and William Carlos Williams. Angleton was an astute. Oh, I don't even know what that word is. The two facets of his personality were combined in disturbing ways. His literary sensibility was nurtured on the close reading taught by the New Criticism with William Empson's classic Seven Types of Ambiguity being the especially formative influence. Empson taught Angleton that no line of poetry had just one meaning, that the job of the reader was to squeeze out every ambiguity and hidden implication. Angleton notoriously applied this methodology, it's happening, guys, my reading capabilities are crumbling, to the interrogation of Soviet defectors, never taking them at face values, but constantly pressuring them to reveal their covert intentions and always postulating that they might be double agents and sometimes torturing them. Ooh. E.E. Cummings! Strange as it may seem, Angleton's use of high modernism for spycraft was hardly unique. The CIA, its first few decades, was led by Ivy League eggheads. Angleton's protege, Cord Meyer, often hired literary critics from the Kenyon Review, an organ of the New Criticism, to work as spies. The CIA had not just an ideology, but also an aesthetic. That's what that word was, aesthetic. Now I get it. The Cold War was a cultural struggle as well as a political one. To demonstrate the superiority of Western civilization, and particularly to win over wavering European intellectuals who might be attracted to communism, the agency funded literary magazines like the Paris Review. Founding editor Peter Matheson was on the CIA's payroll as a spy and sponsored exhibits of abstract expressionism. In the late 1970s, the journalist Richard Ellman researched the aesthetics of the CIA and found documents revealing that the agency seriously considered the suggestion that T.S. Eliot quartets be translated into Russian and dropped by an airplane over the Soviet Union. So they wanted, oh no, down to 44. What have you done? I don't know, Moving Dutchman. I don't know. The Culture War was the precursor to the space race. In both competitions, government largest, Jesus Christ, was deployed to prove that America could outdo the Reds or the Soviets. In order to show that America was fully as sophisticated as fellow travelers like Jean-Paul Sartre, Pablo Picasso, the CIA embraced difficult and experimental art. In the name of spirit, NASA sent astronauts to the moon to wipe out the humiliation of Sputnik. But there was one creative field where the CIA was most populous: music. As historian Hugh Wilford noted in his 2008 study, The Mighty Wurlitzer, how the CIA played America. That's a pretty good one. Yet surprisingly, the CIA appeared reluctant to extend its patronage to America's musical avant-garde experimental serialist composers such as Milton Babbitt and John Cage, both of whom shared many of the same aesthetic ideas and indeed often collaborated with abstract expressionists. Instead, the agency, even in the 1950s, thought that America's musical strength lay in popular work. In a 1955, Frank Wisner, then deputy director of plans, rejected the idea of sending the New York Ballet to Moscow. Our initial presentations to Soviet audiences should aim for mass appeal, Wisner argued. He wanted music that was expressive of our folklore and unmistakably typical of U.S. Wisner was particularly interested in the works of Negro performers that would display their capacity and the opportunities they have in U.S. artistic life. Wisner believed that the first-rate American jazz would serve to demonstrate the breadth and vitality of the American musicianship. Jesus Christ. That's why, Moving Dutchman, because I'm reading like a fucking five-year-old, that's why we lost one. Wisner's enthusiasm for jazz is the key to why the CIA embraced popular culture in music, even as it was more hoity-toity in regard to literature and painting. The CIA was well aware that the Soviet Union was calling attention to American racism. This was a particularly vulnerable point in the competition for support among the decolonization nations of Africa and Asia. Jazz and popular music more broadly would be a way to show America wasn't racist. And so we talked about how the CIA was fucking with Louis Armstrong. The story of the CIA's love for popular music is brought up to date in the splendid podcast called Wind of Change by New Yorker journalist Patrick Radden Keefe. In the 8-episode series, Keefe investigates the rumor that the CIA agents composed the ballad Wind of Change, first performed in 1989 by the German heavy metal group Scorpions and released the following year. The song was a huge hit on both sides of the Iron Curtain, becoming a kind of unofficial anthem for the end of communism. So, the Scorpions, bro. Heavy metal my ass. Hold on. Let's just listen to a little bit of that song. Shut up. And so this was popular in Germany. Let's go, the Scorpions. Oh yeah, this song's the shit. Yeah, this song is fucking sick, dude. But heavy metal.
Soldiers passing by.
Yeah, this song is so awesome.
To the wind of change.
Yeah, this ain't metal. Morbi, I like that you knew what the song was. You're like, that's hot metal, bitch.
The future's in the air. Can feel it everywhere. I'm blowing with the wind of change.
Damn, that's a good one. That's a good song right there.
Walking down the streets, distant memories.
All right, baby, let's go. Fuck yeah, that's the spirit right there. Look at that. The CIA composed that, you guys. That song of freedom and winds of change. That's the CIA, bitch. love it. heavy metal, but the Scorpions do get heavy though. I always misheard the lyrics. Yeah, well there you go. But it's known as the Hasselhoff made the wall go down. Oh yeah, Hasselhoff. I forgot about that. Yeah, they're water. We're on kick, bitch. This is real shit right here, son. Real shit right here, baby. Oh my god, this is ridiculous. I've been looking for freedom. So it was a popular hit on both sides and became a kind of unofficial anthem to end communism, which is very nice. The podcast is very much a detective story, and like all whodunits, deserves to be left spoiler free. But one of its strengths is Keith's places for his history fully in the context of the CIA's history of arts patronage. In the third episode, there's a discussion of the troubled relationship this patronage had with black musicians. The 1955 New York Times wrote, "America's secret weapon is a blue note in a minor key. Right now, its most effective ambassador is Louis Armstrong. But Armstrong was a reluctant ambassador, uncomfortable with doing propaganda for Jim Crow America. He went along on State Department tours, but continued to speak out against racism," which is awesome, right? Fucking Hasselhoff, man. Long live Hasselhoff. David took down the wall himself. He did. Fucking Reagan was like, David Hasselhoff, bring down that wall or tear down that wall. I distinctly remember Ronald Reagan, David Hasselhoff, tear down that wall. With his bare arms, bitch. He didn't even use a sludge. He was just like, in slow motion. You know, because of Baywatch in slow motion. Okay, whatever. In the case of Nina Simone, the CIA had to use trickery, which is what the CIA does. As Wilford uncovered, Simone was sent on a tour to Nigeria in 1961 by the American Society of African Culture, a CIA front organization. As Keith notes, it's one thing for the government to pressure Louis Armstrong to go to Africa on a propaganda mission and have him grudgingly but knowingly go along. It's a very different thing to covertly send an artist on false pretenses. And Nina Simone was no patriot. She was not. Nina Simone was not a fan of America. Whoo, Knight Rider, baby. Yes. Michael, you are driving too fast. Michael, get your penis out of my tailpipe. As Keith notes, we know that. She ended up renouncing the United States and living abroad. She called it the United Snakes of America. And yeah, she lived in Paris, and she was not a rich woman when she died. She had a very hard life, and she was very mentally disturbed, I would say. One of the great merits of Wind of Change is that it directly confronts what is morally troubling about spy agencies funding art. Arguably, the CIA's patronage was one of its most defensible deeds, certainly preferable to fomenting coups or assassinating foreign leaders, but even so, it involved a corruption of art. Right. Exactly. And this is what we're talking about. Fucking fomenting coups and assassinating foreign leaders. That's what they fucking do. as Keith observes, we think of culture, or we want to think of culture, as organic and spontaneous, as purer than politics. Nina Simone clearly did. She felt it gave her a deep connection to the people she met in Nigeria. So it is really unsettling to learn that the hidden hand of the government was at work. It's a feeling of dispossession, like someone picked your pocket. Yeah, I can see that, man. That's not cool. Another virtue of the podcast is that the recuperates the idea of ambiguity, stealing it back from James Jesus Angleton. If Angleton corrupted ambiguity by turning it into a justification for torture, Keefe shows that when ambiguity is properly used, it is an essential tool for moral analysis. Throughout the series, each bit of evidence, each new testimony or historical discovery is examined for its implicit content or possible falsehood. The end result is not Angleton's murk, but the illumination that comes from honestly confronting the limits of knowledge. Wow, this writer was fucking a good writer that I could barely read his writing. We probably should have read the Rolling Stone article so I didn't fucking sound like a douchebag. I mean, Rolling Stones at least writes in words I can read. Yeah, I'm slow. So, interesting shit, man. Interesting shit. Yeah, to get out of here. Yeah, so there was lots of shit going on, man, where the CIA was funding different artists. And, you know, the same thing could be happening today. Let's say, you know, Taylor Swift not directly is contacted by, you know, someone from the president, but maybe they like what she says. And so they fund some of her, you know, they business fronts, they can fund her tours and give her money without her knowing because they're trying to prop her up. They can, you know, they can pay, they don't have to pay her directly, right? They can pay through different business fronts because they have tons of different business fronts to be able to fund people, to be able to uplift their career, right? Like, so they like what Taylor Swift is saying. Taylor Swift was pro Joe Biden back in 2020. She endorsed him. So they could easily keep propping her up by feeding into different business fronts, feeding her money and pulling her more into focus for the public eye because they know that she is a team player. So this is some things they could possibly do, right? Because this is the types of shit they do. I mean, you know, the CIA has tons of Bitcoin, right? Like, you know, they got in there, you know, that they're invested in the stock markets and somehow through different fronts to fund different operations. They were selling cocaine in fucking in Los Angeles to poor black people so they could fund their operations, their covert operations in Nicaragua. Jesus. So this is very possible shit, man. This is a very possible thing that is happening, and they've shown they've done it in the past, and they've only gotten better at it as technology has evolved. So, coming back to the smug asshole, let's see what he says about all this. Period. Her tour audience is actually just CIA personnel. Exactly, Morby. All of her fans are just CIA operatives. All the millions and millions of fans. And maybe we should give them all DJ decks and a laptop so they could all be DJs, CIA DJ operatives. Here we go. Callback.
Anyway. So is Swift a front for a covert political agenda?
Is she?
Primetime obviously has no evidence. If we did, we'd share it. But we're curious. Because the pop star who endorsed Biden...
You should have just led the fucking whole thing with that, sir. Is she an asset of the government? We don't know. There's no evidence. You should have just led with that, fuckface. What a schmuck.
Biden is urging millions of her followers to vote. She's sharing links. And her boyfriend, Travis Kelce, sponsored by Pfizer. And their relationships boosted
brought to
the
you
NFL
by
ratings
Pfizer.
This season, bringing in
fuck
a whole
you.
New demographic.
Pay me.
So how's the PSYOP going? Well, as usual, Biden's not calling the shots because he doesn't even know who Taylor Swift is. He's confused her with Britney Spears and Beyonce.
You could say even this harder than getting a ticket to the Renaissance tour or Britney's tour. She's down in, it's kind of warm in Brazil right now.
Former FBI agent Stuart Kaplan joins us now.
Our fucking president, ladies and gentlemen. President Joe Biden. I don't know. Never mind. Whoever the fuck she is, I don't know. I'm tired. I pooped my pants.
Stuart, is this feasible?
Jesse, the deployment of a PSYOP in the United States in this day and age is still illegal. The national security law prohibits the deployment of PSYOPs or using an operative.
Never stopped them before.
Warfare. However, if I was running Biden's management perception team, I would identify someone who would align themselves with my agenda, such as a Taylor Swift, who has close to 600 million followers. I would target her. I would engage her. And I would get her to do what we used to see as like public service announcements. And that type of enlistment, that type of solicitation is analogous to the old days of deployment of a PSYOP. And so in modern times, with these people having such influence and such, you know, immeasurable amount of followers, she can potentially single-handedly swing voters because of just the amount of followers that she potentially can influence. So the answer is yes, Jesse.
Yeah, because when she...
And, yeah. Yeah, of course. Someone obviously could reach out to her from the Biden camp and be like, hey, we want to know if you were going to be endorsing our president this year. And if so, we'd love for you to, you know, talk about it, make a speech, or could we film you doing something? Again, this is very much a very... This is something that happens all the time. It happens all the fucking time. Again, Obama, Jay-Z, Beyonce, right? All the fucking time. Beyonce sang at the inaugural speech, right? Or the inaugural. God damn it. I'm my brain's shutting down, folks. How are modern U.S. presidents anything but anything else but satire? It's so hard to take any of them seriously. Like, I like Obama, right? Like, he was, like, a very serious president. But, I mean, like, in a way, he was serious and, like, brought more respect back to the United States. But he was still, like, bailing out these bankers and still, you know, killing brown people and... He killed more brown people than fucking George W. Bush. And that was a clown show, too. It was like this. Like, look at this. It was fucking pedo Bill, right? Jeffrey Epstein's butt buddy. You got fucking George W., who couldn't even fucking say a sentence properly. Obama brought some respect, but continued the policies of the neocons of the George Bush era. But again, brought a little respect, right? Donald Trump. I mean, that's just a meme of its own. And then, of course, we got this clown who's fallen asleep, Genocide Joe, falling asleep at the wheel. I mean, you're absolutely right. It's nothing. Our last presidents were all memes. Again, except for Obama, I think Obama brought some respect back to the office, even if he was just, you know, business as usual. And anywho, let's finish this fucking video. Let's get to the fucking bottom of this.
Posted the link to the vote.org. It's like hundreds of thousands of young Taylor Swift fans all of a sudden registered to vote.
Yeah.
I wonder who got possible. To her from the White House or from wherever. Who makes that initial handshake? Is it the binder?
Well, the administration has what they consider a perception optics management team. And those are professionals that go out and identify those people who may be unsuspecting, whether with knowledge or without knowledge, to do these type of campaigns. Now, it is possible that Taylor Swift, quite frankly, does not know that she is being utilized in a covert manner swing voters. But the bottom line is that the Biden administration is savvy, identifying how many followers and how many voters potentially she can influence with either right information or misinformation. She certainly can swing the voters.
Okay, the Stuart, thank you so much. I now know a lot more about Taylor Swift than I ever wanted to know. We appreciate it.
Ugh. All right, so there's that smug prick. So, all that to say, I don't know. But it is possible. It's very possible, and it's not outside the realm of possibility, right? It's something that's not that you could easily see happening, given the history of our country and what the CIA has done in the past. So, is she? I don't know. We probably never know. And even if she is, she's probably unwittingly being used. But I don't think it's just Taylor Swift. There's tons of other people who get tapped for these types of things. Are these spies, is Taylor Swift like some clandestine spy who's fucking assassinating people on tour while she goes around? That'd be awesome. But no, I doubt it. She's just a girl who, you know, who's famous and does music and people love her. But again, the CIA could lift her up, prop her up through different shell companies,